Hello, everyone. I'm Congresswoman Karen Bass, and I am here to lead a discussion on an incredible film, a film that was so great I had to watch it twice, a film that is so historic, especially for this moment in history, while we are watching the trial of Derek Chauvin, who killed George Floyd. The issue of policing is one that is being examined in our nation now. And when I think about the original reason the Black Panther Party started, it was the Black Panther Party for self-defense, to protect community members from the police. And I know when I was growing up, hearing about Fred Hampton, an incredible young leader, only 21 years old, this film talking about his life, talking about the circumstances of the Panther Party in Chicago, is such an important film exactly for today. And so we're gonna have a brief discussion with the writers of the film. And I'd like to ask them to introduce themselves right now, and we will jump straight into a discussion.
Hello, my name is Shaka King.
I'm Keith Lucas.
Will Berson.
And I'm Kenny Lucas.
Why this film? Why did you want to talk about the legacy of Fred Hampton, someone from my generation?
Fred Hampton is just one of those historical figures who just spoke to me, spoke to the time, the tragic nature of his untimely death. It just reverberated to me when we were in college, and I just felt a connection to him. I felt his story deserved to get the proper cinematic treatment by careful filmmakers, and preserving his legacy and augmenting his legacy was a pivotal thing for me and being able to tell this story. It all led from with my love of Fred.
Well, I'll tell you, I can't thank you enough for having made this film. And I remember one of the slogans from the time period: you can kill a revolutionary, but you can't kill a revolution. So what does that mean to you? What does that mean to you, Shaka?
I mean, one of the reasons that we ended the film, with the reveal that Chairman Fred Hampton Jr. was born, weeks after his father's assassination, and to this day is continuing on the legacy and doing, a lot of the same work on the very streets that his father did, is testament to that. Even though I think that's one of the reasons that, Chairman Fred Hampton and, so many of his comrades are willing to put their lives on the line, because they recognized that, ultimately, folks would continue on that work and that legacy. And even if they died, they would inspire others to, just continue the fight.
Well, it was so meaningful to me to see, to hear about Fred Hampton Jr., because I didn't know what happened to his son and to his family. And so bringing that out leaves you with the hope that the struggle continues. So Will, given today, given the young activists of today, what lessons do you think they should take, one from the film and two from the chairman?
Well, going backwards from the chairman, I think that they should take a lesson that it's always been this hard, which might sound discouraging, but I hope is actually heartening. That it's always been this hard, and the real fighters have always been this young. That these were all babies. They were late teens and early 20s. A lot of them dropped out of college to join the revolution full time. And I would hope that is incredibly inspiring by example, and the sacrifice and all that. And to take from the movie, hopefully I would say a yearning to be worthy of everything Fred and the rest of the Black Panther Party fought for, and to aspire to be as good as he was a human being, which is a tall task to be sure, but I would hope there's a little bit of he was a real guy. Let's try to be like that.
And for me, he was older because I was a young teen.
Right.
Think about it now that he was 21 years old, but commanded that much power and that much respect. I appreciated also that the film showed the multiracial character, because I think the Black Panther Party is viewed as a black nationalist, hate white people party. And the film certainly shows that one of the chairman's incredible talents was he went and got everybody. Shaka, the scene where he walks into the white meeting, I don't know what to call it, it had Confederate flags. I mean, today I would call it white supremacists, but I don't think that it was. But why that part? Why did you, it was amazing that you got that part.
Well, I mean, it was, you know, in researching, you know, his life and the work that they did, that the party did, and finding out that they partnered with the Young Patriots who, you know, whose symbol was a Confederate flag. It was just like, this is insane, first of all, that I can look at a photo of, you know, these individuals, you know, together coalition building. But also, this is something that people will never believe. And, you know, they'll watch the movie and say, yeah, no way they made this up. And then they'll go and they'll look back and they'll be as amazed as we are. And so A, because it happened was the reason we put it there. And B, you know, the reason it impressed us was because it's so radical, it's such a radical idea. And, you know, you did allude to the fact that, you know, Young Patriots weren't, you know, a racist organization. They were a political organization who, you know, were fighting for the rights of Appalachian migrants in, you know, Chicago. But at the same time, there were members of that organization that were incredibly racist. And, you know, the fact that Chairman Fred and the Illinois chapter were able to get them to go as far as to change that symbol after, you know, some time of working together. And abandon that symbol is, I think, just a testament to the power that, you know, he and they had.
Many people say, first of all, that the Panthers organized the first Rainbow Coalition. And the way they brought together, you know, the young lords, the young patriots, I mean, they brought everybody together. And a lot of people say about Martin Luther King and Fred Hampton, when they reached the point where they were doing multiracial organizing, when Martin Luther King reached the point where he was talking about economic oppression, mm-hmm. that was when their lives ended. And did you guys raise that? Keith, what were you thinking about when you guys wanted to draw out that part of the film?
I mean, Fred was way more explicit than Dr. King. So he, you know, he became a threat very early on in his life. I mean, I feel like he started getting targeted at the age of what, 14? So, you know, he was always perceived as a threat because of how explicit he was with his Marxism and his critique of capitalism. And so I don't know, I just feel like in writing for his character and putting him in the film, I mean, He was a threat from the beginning, and you saw that with, and then the very first scene you see Hoover and a bunch of cops, and they're literally targeting him. So I think that had everything to do with the fact that he was very explicit with his message.
And you know, one of the things that I appreciated about the film also is that you see Hoover basically ordering the assassination of somebody, and these were things that we lived through. But no one believed. No one believed. So you couldn't go to the press and say the police are trying to kill me. And here we are in the midst of this trial right now, where, as far as I'm concerned, the primary defense is scary black people. And right. Certainly the image of the Panther Party was that as well. Kenneth, how did you guys deal with that image?
I think you know, we all did a great job of contextualizing the Panthers. I think we're all explicitly aware of the campaign to criminalize African Americans. Since the Civil Rights Movement, I mean, especially during mass incarceration, where if you're killed by the police, they immediately look at your criminal record or they look at your drug history. And that essentially allows for them to do whatever they want to blacks, especially blacks who are deemed criminals. I think that started or at least it became more pronounced because of Hoover and because of Nixon's extraordinarily racist campaign against drugs.
Yes, exactly. And some would wonder whether it happened for many, many years before that as well. Well, so what about the character who basically is the informant? What about him? And I mean, there's a lot of different ways you could have gone about the movie, a lot of different ways you could have talked about the Panther Party, but there was focus on him and his trials and tribulations that he went through.
We recognized instantly, well, this is an opportunity to make a political statement as well, in the sense of, you know, the best way to show who Chairman Fred Hampton was to show who he was not. And, you know, we have an opportunity to contrast, you know, two very different ideologies, and, you know, the ideology of a Marxist socialist and the ideology of a capitalist, which, you know, I think we did through the character of William O'Neill. And you get to explore the dangers of being a political, you know, you get to impart, you know, I don't want to call them lessons, but just certainly, I think, our opinions of, you know, the dangers of being apolitical and really prioritizing self-interest and adopting the ethos that this country puts forth, you know, by and large. So, you know, that was the reason to make him a primary character for us.
But I appreciated that you also showed him as a victim too, in the sense that he was stuck. He, yes, there were other choices he could have made, no question about that, but he was also stuck, he was exploited, and there were different types of informants during those times. There was those type, but then there were also just straight cops that came in, right. and that was their job, especially young rookie cops. They would take the young cops because they hadn't been known on the street and have them go in and be informants. So I appreciated the way you humanized him as well. Because even at the end, when he's meeting with them, and basically they give him a business, that's what he gets, you know, out of selling everybody out. You know, I think you were showing, you know, and Will, maybe you could respond to this, you tried to show the turmoil.
It's very overtly the 30 pieces of silver and almost certainly not worth it in the moment the character having to kind of confront the deeds by virtue of being faced with the reward is even more, is kind of the final act of reflection or self-reflection, which the character is obviously not very good at naturally. But I think another thing that's really important about that character beyond the political contrast between capitalism and socialism is psychologically they're kind of shadow selves. And I think we really, like you were saying, Congresswoman, that O'Neill is in his own way a victim, that it was kind of important for us to say that, you know, and they were both from Maywood, that this like sense that if the things had been a little bit different for O'Neill, he might have been a really great Panther too, you know, that kind of the subtleties and ambiguities in their contrast, I think was important too.
But I couldn't figure out, Keith, where he was coming from, because it did seem like, you know, he was different at different times in the movie, but it did seem like he was genuine. It seemed like he was genuine in terms of, you know, committed to the cause, but always under threat and conflicted. What was the intent, Keith? To show him as genuine, but conflicted, or he was just all corrupt?
I think he was genuinely committed to himself.
Okay.
I think that he was committed to self-preservation. I don't think he ever fully embraced the Panther's ideology. I don't think so. I mean, again, I it's hard to know, but just based on some of the decisions he made and just his general character, I think he was just committed to himself. And even to the very end that, you know, and when you juxtapose that with Fred, you're like, oh man, this is a guy who completely gave himself to others. I mean, it's again, when the two stories are juxtaposed, it becomes even more powerful.
Yeah, I mean, I think just
oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead, Shaka.
Just to, just to go back to the sort of sympathetic portrayal of him, if you will, which, you know, I don't think it's necessarily sympathetic as much as I think it gives a little bit of context to his actions and choices. But I think ultimately, like, yes, he was a victim, but I think his victimhood started way earlier than when the FBI, you know, he fell into their trap. I think his victimhood started when, you know, he was born poor and black and told to want all these things that were completely out of his reach outside of probably illegal means, you know, and, you know, they dangle that in front of us all the time. And it's really hard to resist. And, you know, we are faced with decisions like the ones he had to make on a smaller scale every single day. And a lot of times we think we make the choice that Chairman Fred would have made, but we make the choice that William O'Neill would have made. And so the whole reason to show him that way is to so that you see yourself in him.
What was not in the film? What would you have wanted? What more would you have wanted to do?
If we'd had another hour, I think I would have loved to include the role of State's Attorney Edwin Hanrahan and Mayor Daley and really like delve a little bit into, you know, the conspiracy behind the assassination, which is very convoluted and ultimately doesn't make a lot of sense. But it would have been nice to explore that. And it would have also been nice to elevate some of the other Illinois chapter members, you know, like Doc Satchel and Wanda Ross and Shea Brooks.
Well, I can't thank you enough for the film. I really can't. I mean, it's very personal and meaningful to me because it was a very formidable part of my life. And I remember it very, very well. So thank you. Thank you for telling the story.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Nice talking to you, Congresswoman. Nice talking to you. Take care.
Absolutely. Bye, guys.
Yeah, guys.
Peace, guys.